Welcome back to Toy Story 2. So, Toy Barn Encounter. Let's see what this is.
So, are we finally gonna get that boss fight with New Buzz now?
Yes, actually. But he's doing that in a vehicle.
Remind me again, Ted, do they ever specifically say that it's Buzz inside that thing?
Yes, I don't know if you listened to them, but at least for when I played it, yes, it actually has voice clips of the evil Buzz taunting you.
Oh, okay.
Also, wouldn't Zurg be using those?
Why would Buzz use Zurg soldiers against us, though?
Maybe
because this version of Buzz knows the only way to beat Zurg is to think like it.
I guess.
On an unrelated note, the Buzz Lightyear TV series is actually pretty damn good.
It is.
But Buzz Lightyear is Star Command. Yeah, I love that show.
Yeah. And now, I think it's on Disney Plus, is it?
It is.
It's not on our Disney Plus.
Well, okay, fine. It's on American Disney Plus. Well, it's only a matter of time.
Is it on American Disney Plus? Oh, wait, you would know. You have an American Disney Plus account.
Now, there's a site called whatsondisneyplus.com that does give that information, Joe. You can check it.
Some people really do have too much free time.
I guess it's good to know.
That's the thing, too. As we've just demonstrated, it kind of is very useful for a lot of people, so...
Yeah, because, you know, different versions of different systems, you might want to know, and with stuff like ExpressVPN, you can actually enjoy the benefits that other versions of...
I don't remember if this
video is actually not sponsored by ExpressVPN.
I'm actually wondering if there's a Netflix equivalent, because there's also... similar issues with Netflix. Fresh Prince of Bel-Air is not on American Netflix, but it's on various European countries.
What?
I'm not getting
that. That's right, Jerry. It's not on our Netflix, but it is
that's
on yours.
Stupid.
Never mind the fact that it's an American show by one of the most charismatic American actors. But whatever.
I think it's a matter of licensing. Some European versions were better handled, so it was easier to regain the contracts.
It's unfortunately kind of a similar case like Friends. Like, yeah, it was such a momentous occasion when Friends got added to Netflix, and then it got taken off of Netflix. In America, mind you.
In America.
Alright. He has the voice of a zombie angel.
I'll just say this. It's like Scott the Waz said, when other companies started to get greedy and wanted their own streaming service, that's where the problems really occurred, because Netflix was such a great meeting point for a lot of them. But now they gotta have their own streaming service. Here's the problem, when you divide everything into streaming services, unless you're as big as, say, like Disney, you won't have as much bang for your buck as, say, Netflix does, because Netflix is still... kind of ground zero for a lot of this meeting. Hell, even companies that did make their own streaming services still left a lot of their stuff on Netflix, almost like it was a safety net.
I love I love the derp face on Buzz's model.
I think that should have killed.
Oh, look, a bonus movie. But this one is actually, if I remember correctly, it's actually one of the better bonus movies. Let me check. I don't remember which
guess.
One is
this.
This
is the one. That...
Yeah, this one actually does work for this point. So yeah, it's fine.
See, Pedro, that's what we got for you to do the stuff in the actual level.
Sure, sure.
Oof. Well.
But yeah, honestly, bonus movie-wise, this one actually does flow well with the story, ironically.
Why couldn't you just have the movies happen and that's it? Like, why even make them, quote-unquote, bonus?
Like, it's to make the player feel like they earned something, I guess.
Yeah.
Ah, destroy Buzz Lightyear! Zurg vision, haha.
Destroy Buzz Lightyear! There we go.
destroy Mars Lightyear.
Imagine any kid and parent who sees this sight before them.
It would be quite the interesting thing. All right, let's go to the next one. Elevator hop. You might remember this bit because that's where that's how they go from both bottom to top and from top to bottom when it comes to climbing this building.
Okay, let's move. Mission lock. Have infiltrated enemy territory without detection and are making our way through the bowels of Zerg's fortress.
You know, I think that buzzer out went to his head.
Oh, you know what's more interesting thing, Jova? Since you were talking about the world building in Toy Story 1, one particular thing that I found find interesting when it comes to the interactions between new Buzz and the other toys is how, remember how in the first movie when Buzz was super deluded and for some reason all the other toys were completely enabling his delusions?
Yeah.
But in this movie they're just as what the hell are you doing as Woody was in the first movie. Interesting change in behavior here. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying this ruins anything. I'm just saying it's an interesting fact that I noticed. That's all I'm saying.
I get what you mean. Like again, so I guess
you know something we don't.
So I guess now we're playing as new Buzz.
And yeah, this is actually the most of the vertical.
The
most developed of the vertical levels. Basically, it's all about these elevator shafts, and you need to find ways to actually progress upward. It's actually another one of my favorites.
Yeah, this is actually one of the better levels. Actually, this is at it's a bit more straightforward than the other ones. The switch in the control room will activate this shortcut.
There's nowhere to go but up
or down. If you fall down, you'll go down, so yeah.
thankfully, there's no falling damage.
No. Well, it's a collect-a-fun platformer, too. Like, Mario 64 had it, and that was a bad idea. So, you should never... You should never have falling damage on a platformer, period, because, you know, like...
But Pedro, Bubsy had it, which means he's clearly, you know, breaking the mold as a result.
Well, it's not really so much breaking the mold when Mario 64 did it first. But
okay. One really has Bubsy to wonder.
Bubsy came out before that.
Oh, did it?
Actually,
the first Bubsy on Super Nintendo.
Oh, right, I forgot. No, okay, sure. I thought you were talking about Bubsy 3D.
Yes, it actually has falling damage for some reason.
So, you're telling me...
platformer evolving, so on. Falling damage in a 3D platformer, I kind of get it in a weird sixth sense. But falling damage in a 2D platformer? Are you high?
Okay, so what you're telling me, basically, is that Miyamoto played Bubsy and thought, you know what I could put in Mario 64? Fall damage.
Well, again, to be fair, it makes more sense in Mario 64 at least because, you know... when you fall incredibly high in that point, you know, you can kind of get why. And you know what, to be fair, at the very least in Mario 64, there's a way to avoid the falling damage by ground pounding near the ground. With Bubsy, you can't avoid it. And Jesus Christ, so much stuff will kill you easily in that game.
And we found Mr. Potato Head's shoe. Now let's see if we can find him, so he can give us whatever he has. Go. There he is. Wow, thanks, Buzz. In return for finding my foot, I will let you use the grappling hook. You can aim at the special targets in visor view using the trigger buttons and you can I can launch the hook. Anyway.
Basically, this is also basically the way on how you also actually play the level Howlies and Gowlies, because that is a sneak, a stealth, kind of like... vertical level in a sense of that it doesn't look like at first, but most of the stuff to do actually has to be done by using the grappling hook.
The way it's used, it's actually very similar to how you use the hook shot in the earlier 3D Zelda games, actually.
Yeah. This time you don't have to eat anything that's wooden.
The weird thing is that you have to pick it up every time, though, to use it. That's weird.
Well, actually... wait, do you? No, I don't think so.
Yeah, as you can see, there is a time number you can use it.
Oh, okay. No, that I know. Like, Jova made it seem like we have to pick it up every time we use once.
well, more like so you have to pick it up to use it. It's Sounds so weird for a power-up. I mean, I get some power-ups of ammunition, but of all things to have ammunition,
I guess,
like a grappling hook.
I'm guessing they don't... Well, actually, no, that doesn't make much sense. You need the grappling hook to complete this level, so it doesn't make much sense to put you in a position where you can't use it.
It doesn't make sense real-life or video game-wise. In real-life-wise, a grappling hook doesn't really have finite ammo. At best, maybe it's based off of how long you can reach with it. But aside from that, a grappling hook literally has the line which can be used over and over again after you retract it. Gameplay-wise, it makes even less sense. Why would you give a grappling hook ammo slots?
It's weird. It doesn't actually become a problem, to be fair, because you can get ammo easily enough anyway. There are various pickups over the course of the levels. So you'll be fine.
I will say this, it's not exactly the most friendly thing for people who like to explore a lot with a grappling hook, but yeah, I guess like you said, ammo is there enough.
Well,
that's
the thing, Jova. You can only use the grappling hook in specific spots that the game intended. You cannot actually experiment with it. It's made for you have to use it in the exact same specific spot that the designers intended, basically.
My god, you can definitely... Yeah, the age in this game definitely shows in regards to stuff like that.
To be fair, I actually don't mind that too much, actually. Like, it wouldn't be a problem. It's just that the only real issue is that the grappling hook is not exactly fun to use. Let me explain what I mean. Every time you get to one of these spots, it's always the exact same thing. Get into first-person mode, point, and click. There you go. And it just brings you there. It's always the exact same thing. So it becomes this. Required task that you always have to perform the exact same way every time. So it's not really an interesting.
There are toys in the vent.
While it is true that it would have been nice to have some experimentation. True, it's more so the fact that it's not a particularly fun gimmick. As in, like, it's literally just there's another spot for the grappling hook, let's use it again, and there we go. Like, it's very by the numbers, and, you know, like, it's very typical, old-school 3D platformer design. Go ahead, sorry, that was my bad. Go ahead.
I can't help but get the feeling that, you know, they put all budget for, like, the precise camera controls into the first-person view, and that's why everything has to be done from it. Let's look at it from, say, okay, I know that this game is a lot newer, but the Arkham series, it's incredibly simple. You find anything that you can latch onto with the regular camera, boom, you can use the grappling hook.
To be fair, Jova, there's like a difference of 2 generations of consoles and some potential previous games the inspiration from.
Like I said, I get that, but even still, by this game's genre, though, surely they could have at least given the more precise camera in third-person mode to not have to force you to go into first-person mode every time.
I'm personally more bothered by the fact that John actually told designers to put fans in these parts, because this is just making it unnecessarily more frustrating. Like, I'm sitting there, there you go, see? I'm trying to aim, and this fucking thing completely throws me off. This was unnecessary. This is not challenging, this is just annoying.
Again, not helped by having to switch to first person, but yeah.
There you go, I still made it.
Yeah.
Alright.
But apparently there are toys hanging out in the vents.
Mm-hmm.
So people just lose toys in vents now, I guess.
This was actually a very common problem in early 3D platformers. Okay. Hi Buzz, if you find my 5 missing baby, you're a toy mouse. How the hell do you have babies?
Well,
hey Jova, you were talking about asking you to think about shit. How about this?
It's part of a set.
Toy mice can have babies, apparently.
Or maybe it's part of a set.
Never mind. Yeah, he's right. He's right, actually.
Unfortunately, though, Toy Story 4 just bring up the idea of romance, so... Yeah, I mean, if...
Ah, come on, Jova. To be fair, romance has been a thing since the first movie. Alright, so for this, can you guys still hear me, by the way?
Yes.
Ah, okay. You all went silent all of a sudden.
Wondering what you were actually going to do. Yeah. It's another Switch puzzle.
It's another Switch puzzle, yes. God, what was I gonna say? But no. Taylor actually has a good point. Yeah, it can be just part of a set of toys.
It's kind of like how, you know, Mrs. Potato was created to be, you know, female equivalent love interest to Mr. Potato.
Sure.
Although to be fair, it's not completely in the wrong to bring up that implication because, again, thanks to good old Toy Story 4, they do imply it's possible for toys to have relations and somehow they have offspring.
They do? Wait. What the
hell? Okay. Maybe not so much the offspring, but... Okay, a toy can apparently form romance groups. So you have to wonder, though, how would that romance get consummated?
Jova, one of the things that were majorly created, you know, as a staple of toys for boys and girls was the fact that Ken and Barbie were created without any genitalia at all for that specific reason.
Oh, don't worry, Gio. Robot Chicken handled how they can still do
of
it.
Of course.
Jova, this is one of those things, like, you know, how characters go to the bathroom. It's one of those questions you just don't ask because you probably won't like the answer.
Oh my god, I forgot how loud this level is.
I know, I have to turn the video on.
What was that?
Okay, to be fair,
toys, and to them, an elevator shaft would sound good.
Yeah, I was about to say that.
Gotta be honest, Jova, when I played this level myself, I actually don't remember that it was, like, this loud.
Unfortunately, it was.
But yeah, like, sure. but like me and Joe were saying, yeah. To be fair, I can actually see the logic behind this. I still think they could have possibly. This is one of those things where, okay, yeah, technically this makes sense, but at the same time, I don't think anybody would have complained that the elevator is too quiet. You could afford to not do this.
It's a case
unless you're one of those really picky.
Seriously. Except for those unreasonable people that I've just brought up, nobody's gonna actually play this level and think, you know what? These elevators are too quiet. Yeah. This game is ruined forever.
Who's expecting realism out of a toy store?
Not just that, Wibbs. Like, it doesn't even have to do with realism per se. It has more to do with, suspension of disbelief. Okay, you don't need to be super real. Okay, let me put it like this. It's kind of like what James Rolfe said in his AVGN review of the Die Hard NES game. Yes, it is true. They did that thing where, you know, like, you step on broken glass and you have damage to your feet, just like in the movie. But, yeah, there are times when you should do it like the movie, but there are times when... it's not really necessary. I don't think anybody was clamoring for feet damage in a Die Hard game. So
here's the thing, if they found a way to compensate for that, you know, it would have made sense and still, you know, have props for realism. But gotta be honest, part of the entire thing on how Toy Story is built is at least a minimal bit of realism, because a lot of the slapstick happen because realistic physics sometimes happen to toys in some kind of fashion.
Sure.
It's just a matter of deciding where the line is. Also, enjoy Woody in one of the few moments of the game he's actually in. No, seriously, I can't get enough of the fact that, at least for my country, they advertise this game so much of being equal part for Woody and Buzz, but Woody just shows up for one of his clips from the movie and at the very end of the game.
So yeah, this is phony.
In my country, we just...
Not phony Buzz, but,
New Buzz. That's the thing, we were technically playing as New Buzz, I guess.
Usually I just call him New Buzz. It's interesting. Well, for me, in here we just use the English name, so...
No, actually, we use it as well. I was talking about how the game was advertised for my country.
Didn't you say earlier, though, that the game was renamed to Buzz and Woody or something along those lines?
It was renamed, but I'm talking about actual game, you know, presence. The articles were talking about...
Ah, okay, sure.
You know, and these was more equal.
Okay then.
And then he banged his head and went.
Of all the moments of dissonance between the cutscenes and the levels, this is the one that's the most.
Okay.
Really?
If someone actually likes this game, I'm gonna say this was supposed to have been the level where you actually played as Baldi.
Bullseye is talking. Why is Bullseye talking, even though he's literally famous for being silent?
It's weird because Pixar was involved in the making of this game, because remember, Pixar is known, and we know this because there was a guy from Avalanche that was interviewed about this. Pixar was always involved in the video game tie-ins to their movies. Dan Scanlon, the director of Monsters University and Onward, he was the one that was actually the Pixar consultant for the Incredibles video games. So Pixar has always been involved in the video game tie-in. So I really have to wonder why they allowed the breaking of Bullseye's character there.
Well, okay, let's ignore that. This level. So technically the characters have accomplished what they want to do. So you have to ask yourself, why are they lingering around here? Just literally, this level should be solved technically by just talking to Woody, technically.
Again, Jova, I'm sticking to my theory.
Woody is not here.
Again.
Even though he was literally in the cutscene.
Again, Jova, I stick to my theory that I'm willing to bet that most likely what happened was Traveler Stills was trying to make an original 3D platformer, and then Disney came up to them and said, hey, we want you to do the Toy Story 2 video game. And John thought, well, we can apply the game engine we've built to this. So they already had a lot of the level design implemented. And as a result, they plastered the Toy Story 2 story onto already pre-made levels and the assets as well, of course.
The problem with that theory is that, like you said, Pixar were involved, so surely Pixar would have told them a way to actually make stuff fit if, you know, they were involved. So
it's weird.
Because in games after this and stuff like Kingdom Hearts, I hear Disney and Pixar were very protective of representation of the films in the game.
It's a two-way, Dwebs. Pixar was actually very open to what Nomura wanted to do with Monsters, Inc. and Toy Story. In fact, Pixar went on later to say that they were very satisfied with what the Toy Story and Monsters, Inc. worlds did. In fact, they said...
To the point that they even said that at least the Toy Story portion is canon.
Yeah,
the Toy Story movies.
Yeah, they said...
Well, they liked it that much.
They did. Oh, I liked it too.
Toy Story now. So every time I watch Toy Story now, I gotta have in my mind, oh yeah,
this is in the same continuity.
shouldn't Sora, Donald, and Goofy come in to help them?
It's okay, Driz, because technically the events of Kingdom Hearts 3 happen in between Toy Story 1 and Toy Story 2. So it makes sense that Sora, Donald, and Goofy aren't around to help them in 2 or 3.
They also have a storyline that explains other stuff, but back to this. Okay. True, yes, Pixar was involved in this game. I just like, okay. Okay, again, you have to understand, everybody. I grew up playing the first game first. The first game, remember, this is a game made by the exact same team that made the first game that we commented before this one. So for me personally, you know, because I was a big fan of Traveler's Tales at the time, and I still kind of am, because I really like the LEGO games. And you can joke all about the LEGO machine thing that you want, but the LEGO games are actually pretty darn good.
Seriously, the LEGO games have been running for, like, over a decade now, and they're still good.
Mm-hmm. They're actually pretty darn good. I love the humor in particular. But it's just one of those cases where Traveler's Tales did such a stellar job with the first Toy Story game, to the point where I would consider it the second best of the Mega Drive Disney tie-in games after Aladdin, you know, in the sense that it did such a fantastic job in taking as many scenes from the movie and adapting them into gameplay levels and set pieces, you know. It was basically a masterclass on how you can do this kind of thing. And Toy Story 2 completely froze that philosophy in the garbage can. Woody.
I do have to wonder if the reason Pixar were okay with this was because they went in with the bad mentality of, oh, you know, for a video game, it works fine enough. Just throw the cutscenes in there, they look fine enough.
Or more like, again, they wanted to just, they thought that just, you know, showcasing what happened in the movie wouldn't be enough. So they needed to be told to, like, expand stuff that wasn't potentially just told in the movie. Again, a thought process that was very common among PlayStation Disney games. Again, I don't know if you played it, Pedro, but the Atlantis video game is pretty identical in modus operandi. There are a lot of levels that, technically speaking, potentially have nothing to do with the game, or nothing to do with the movie, aside from maybe a passing mention or a bit of a minor showcase during the montage, for example. But they're there, and it makes sense they would have been part of a journey that Milo and the others would have taken.
I'll take your word for it for now, but let me ask you this then. Does the Atlantis game have that problem where you see a clip from the movie, and then right after the clip is over, suddenly you're in a completely unrelated level to what you just saw?
I it's been actually a bit since I played it, but I'm gonna dare say yes.
Okay.
I wonder when Al comes back in here. What if he's gonna notice all the trash that's been thrown around in his room?
Oh, it gets even better, Reeves. I don't know if Pedro showcased it, but you can actually flood the bathroom multiple times.
If I remember correctly, I do show it, yes.
Also, Al apparently has toy vultures flying around. Like, I get that Al is a fan of Woody, but dang, I didn't know he turned his apartment into a Western.
What was I gonna say?
I'd say the music is pretty keen.
Well, Woody's Roundup was a Western show.
Oh, I know.
Don't get me wrong, Teo. I completely understand the idea. Remember, the first Toy Story game did this as well, where we implemented the Nightmare Buzz deleted subplot.
That was something that was still present. I'm talking about complete original stuff, but it instead, you know, fills in the potential gap that the movie had.
Sure. No, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that, Teo. I just wish the game would be a bit more, seamless in the way it's built, because my main thing is the fact that we have these cutscenes from the movie, and the levels seem so completely separate from the actual scenes themselves. You know,
that's the thing. I mean, call me selfish for that, but I do kind of separate the two things. I always thought again that the cutscenes in the movie were just taken from the movie, but the way the levels were progressed were just basically a retelling of how the game was, how the story was constructed in the game.
Sure.
It may just be me, but I wouldn't say that they're completely different. I mean, don't get me wrong. It's by no means a perfect or necessarily even great job, but I'd say that, maybe if they just moved around a few scenes, it would be much better. Like, I mean, it's not a complete train wreck, honestly.
No. I mean, I'm not saying
okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Two, for the most part, complement the levels that we're going into fine enough. Like, we're heading out onto the streets. Okay, we get a streets level. That's fine enough. I think the issue more so has to come with when it gets egregious, like, with new Buzz versus old Buzz or whatnot. And then, scenes like this where, okay, if you've seen the movie, you're probably thinking, shouldn't they have just had the talk with Buzz or something? Like, you literally have to ask yourself, what are they doing here? Like, literally, what are they doing? That said, though, it is by no means an excuse, mind you, but I can kind of see the mentality of, hey, it's a video game, throw in some fun stuff, which technically they did succeed in doing. But yeah, if you're someone who's looking at it as the full package and being an adaptation of the movie, I can see where the disappointment stems from. The problem is this was still in sort of that time where games weren't entirely renowned for their story. Oh, don't get me wrong, there was definitely a rise in games that were definitely, paying mind to the story. But games that actually, focused on the story-wise regarding adaptations would not be in that big an overdrive, unfortunately.
Go ahead.
Hell, technically, even the first Toy Story game wasn't that big on story. It just so happened so that they did a very seamless job of tying things together. But the story there was relatively minimal as well. This one tries to do a bit more of an expanded take on it. However, it shows how that can apparently be more difficult for staff. I will say this, I do feel like Toy Story 3 in general was definitely the best one at, adapting things, expanding things, and, the whole package of
things. I actually agree with that as well, yeah. I actually agree with that. Go ahead, Taylor, say your piece.
Oh, wait, I thought I said everything.
Oh, it looked like you were about to say something. Okay, in that case, that's fine. I mean, that's not even my big, my thing. Okay, let me put it this way. To me, when it comes to making a video game tie-in to one of these things, for me, the most important thing is to make a gameplay loop that I think represents the spirit of the movie the best you can, which is something that I think...
And now we skip to Zurg.
Well, remember, we're now actually in the apartment, which means the Zurg boss fight is next.
Yeah. I think the problem context-wise for this is like, well, you're wondering, hey, why are the two buzzes now working together?
Okay. To be fair, again, I'm pretty sure that this was one of those cases where they... Okay, you've seen the movie, okay? You know how this goes.
Okay, let me actually mention this. This is also the start where the boss fight starts to become a bit shitty, because the only way to defeat the boss is your laser is ineffective. You actually have to go close and personal and use the spin attack.
Yep.
There you go.
Like your crash bandicoots.
And you have to do that for all of the bosses from
boss,
now on. It's kind of lame.
What are you doing to your own farm?
I will say this. I like the Zurg boss battle in Toy Story 3 a lot more. But anyway.
You actually get to fight
Okay.
Remember, Tail, we have the...
That's actually one of my favorite bits from the movie.
Like I said,
them pastiche the whole I am your father.
Remember, Tara, like I said, we finally get to play the Buzz Lightyear video game in Toy Story 3.
Oh, right.
So,
In the movie, it didn't even appear in.
My guess is Shiroi, Avalanche fought. Oh my god, nobody's ever gotten out of the way to do that, have they? Fine, we'll do it ourselves then.
I kind of get why they didn't do it for this game, because, you know, that was more linear than the actual gameplay. Still does not excuse the fact, though. I mean, come on, it was
a no-brainer.
So damn obvious.
Yeah, okay, it's like I said, like, again, it's not even has to do, okay, I can get over the story, gameplay segregation. My major thing, one of the reasons why I'm not a big fan of this game in particular, personally, is because I feel like I said before, like, the best way to go about it to me when it comes to making a video game tie into a movie is to try to do a kind of game, gameplay-wise, that represents the spirit of the movie the best you can. I believe that David Perry's Aladdin game did this by making that game an action platformer based on set pieces. Again, the movie has a lot of action set pieces, so it's perfect fit.
Shame about the sucky final boss aside.
True.
But it was time constrained, so come on.
I'm sorry, Tio, that final boss was lame. I mean, okay, it's like a lot of people have said. If you combine aspects from the Capcom Aladdin game with the David Perry Aladdin game, you would have the ultimate one. Like, aspects like, you know,
For me, it's one of those things where if they had the usual development time that games had at the time instead of just 3 months, I'm confident that David and his team would have made a brilliant, brilliant game all around. But whatever.
Yeah,
It's only a what if.
I do question though. How the hell did Buzz Lightyear come out of this guy? In Canada, I mean.
Dwebs, you're overthinking it. I don't want to think about how Zurg somehow birthed Buzz.
That should have been a plot line in Buzz Lightyear and Star Command.
Well, consider this. Maybe he's human underneath all that.
That is probably also a possibility.
The longest time, I thought Zurg was either a really advanced robot.
Well, remember, Dwibs, the booming voice is for the exact same reason as Darth Vader, and the pastiche element.
Well, to be fair, Dwibs, as we saw in the Buzz Lightyear movie, you know, his right-hand man did get a cool sleek armor, which made him seem robotic, but when he takes off the helmet and reveals that he's Buzz's old partner, you know, so who knows, maybe Zurg's sporting some of that.
Another thing that I really don't like about this boss is how a lot of times Zurg will go out of the platform's bounds, so there, like that, so basically it gets to a point where I'm basically just waiting, so it's really frustrating.
You think that spinning would help you automatically reflect the ball,
but anyway, yeah. Like I said, the Perry's Aladdin game, I believe that Traveller Sales First Story game also did a fantastic job of making a great linear action platformer based on the movie. And I genuinely believe that the best way to go about for this game would have been, like I said before, a Crash Bandicoot style of 3D platformer rather than a Mario 64 style of 3D platformer that would have allowed for them to have proper set pieces, much like Crash Bandicoot has the boulders and shit like that. It would have allowed for them to properly. That's how I would have gone about it if I were hired back then to make a. I would have gone with a Crash Bandicoot style of platformer, rather than a Mario 64 style of platformer. I think that's the formula that fits Toy Story the best, personally. All right. Yeah, this like Tails said. Yeah, this
bot. Quite the damage sponge.
It's not even just that, Joe. It's more so the fact that it can be really hard to damage him because he won't stay fucking still.
Okay, to be fair, Peter, you don't really have to charge the attack all the time. You can just do a simple spin when you're around. The thing that I noticed is that you're not really doing a common tactic that a lot of people use is to jump attack. That allows you to dodge more projectiles and have a better, you know. Attack position,
also helps
both for the speed, both for the spinning and for the laser.
I guess
it also helps give you more speed, so you can keep up with him as well.
If it helps my case, this is probably one of the lesser of the tie-in games that I played as a kid. So I don't have as much practice with this one as I have some of the others.
Yay! We just killed Zerg.
Bonus movie. No, Rex, I don't want to save my game. Not just yet.
Oh.
Sleek, take the pedals. Rex, you navigate. Ham and potato, operate the levers and knobs.
This particular sequence was also showcased, I remember, in an interview with Roy Disney when he was presenting Fantasia 2000. He's actually was presenting at least the VHS copy that I had.
It turned green! Hurry! Alright, here we go.
Yeah, put it in stick.
Yo.
Alright, so tune in next time where we finish off the game.
See ya.
See ya.